this is basically a synthesis of labor market studies that we did with the MT students in these four states, which was more detailed, but also the inputs we got from the 50 odd fieldwork students that worked with us. They did spend a lot of time. We basically gave them a set of questions. IRMA fieldwork is a 2-month fieldwork where all of them, or groups of two, or sometimes even one, student lived for 2 months in one village. So we asked them, in your village, look at what is happening in Narega. I don't think I need to really talk about these details, but the idea I want to give that the scale of Narega is huge, and therefore the impact that can take on labour markets is also significant. So it's no surprise if you're going to generate 2.5 billion percentage of employment completely at you in a labour market, then the dynamics of the labour market will change. Now, these are some of the impacts I will talk about. One is, of course, the income impact. We are providing income to people, or additional income to people who were earning less earlier, or in many cases, like Narega mentioned, who were not in the labor market at all. So there is an income effect, which has its own multiplier effect. There is segmentation of labor market, and I think Nisha also touched upon that, where women and older and less able people go for the lighter Narega work, whereas the able-bodied men or the young men continue to earn much higher than Narega wages in their previous jobs. There is greater bargaining power for labor. I think also in the Kerala case showed that what Narega does is that it sets a wage floor. The minimum wage is offered by Narega, then becomes the starting point of negotiation in the labor market outside Narega. Sometimes the effect on the market is additive, as was the case in Kerala, as was also the case in Rajasthan. We found that there were high caste women who would have never ever dreamt of doing unskilled mud or this kind of labor. But then once they realize that it's basically lighter work and you just have to go and sit there for hours and you can earn some money. So they also started joining the labor market. But sometimes it is substituted. And that happens when the market wage rates before Narega are not significantly higher than what Narega is offering. In South Gujarat, for example, in the Netrang area, I saw that the wage rate in the market was still only 40 rupees per day, and Narega was offering 100 rupees. So in places like that, there is of course substitutive effect. Labor from the agricultural markets is moving out and going into Narega. Narega was expected to have an impact on distressed migration. I don't think we have very clear-cut answers on this, but I will tell you what the impressions we got from the field study. And of course, the impacts have been different in different areas. And what we have done is try to make some kind of a classification of four different kinds of interactions between Narega and labor market. So the wage income and segmentation impacts, the labor markets have obviously become tighter. There is new opportunity cost of time for the laborers. Now nobody would want to work the whole day for 60 rupees when they can earn 100 rupees in Narega. Like I mentioned, it creates a new wage floor. The labor have started demanding better facilities. That's because Narega not only comes with, I think for the first time, a rigorous implementation of the minimum wages, but also minimum working conditions. So even outside Narega, laborers have started demanding better facilities. There is segmentation. There is one which is the Narega labor market, which is not very productivity sensitive. I think so far at least, the focus of Narega has been on creating more and more percentage of employment rather than making that employment very productive. And then there is the residual market, which is the open market, which is highly productivity sensitive and is also willing to pay higher wages. And these impacts have been at variable depth and degree. One interesting thing we found from our survey of 75 villages was that it was not only in Kerala but in several of these states that we studied, women found NREGA work very attractive for various reasons. In Kerala there were also some specific reasons like Kudum Shri, but this work was close to home, it offered better wages than women usually would get in the open market. It gave them disposable income which they could spend the way they wanted rather than, you know, getting kind of like a pocket money from their fathers or husbands. It provided convenient facilities. I don't know any other public works program which even provides for fresh facilities. And it is this general perception of it being light and poorly monitored. The additive impact we've already discussed, and then we saw that the result of NREGA on the residual labor market has been different for men and women, and that the wages of women have risen much faster than the wages of men in the residual market. So as a result, the ratio of male to female wages has come down from 1.4, and this is specifically for the 75 villages where we studied. I understand that they may not be representative of all these four states, to 1.3. The impact on migration is somewhat unclear because we got mixed indications from our field studies. Where our field study was in migrant source destinations, the impressions we got was that migration continues unabated because migration offers much higher compensation than NREGA can offer. Especially where the migration was going, for example, in South Rajasthan, where people migrate to Ahmedabad, NREGA could not match in any way the kind of money they could earn by going to Ahmedabad. But in the migrant destinations, for example in North Gujarat, a lot of villages reported that the people, the number of migrants coming in have significantly reduced. So we could not reconcile these two, you know, very conflicting pieces of evidence that we got. The only tentative kind of conclusion we can make is that it is possible that there is some effect on distressed migration. So, or the distress in the migration has reduced. So now there is some opportunity of work closer to home. But if there is opportunistic migration opportunities, you know, that still continues.
Then,
should
it be that
in
this number of villages you are telling?
Yeah.
In the number
of
villages, not houses?
No. Villages. So agricultural migration. Then these are some other interesting results from two or three other studies. One is that it says that the size of landholding is a negative predictor of participation, which I see as a very positive effect. I don't know what you people make of it, which means that if you have larger landholding, then there is less probability that you will participate in NREGA, which means that it is that self-targeting of NREGA which is being talked about is actually also happening. Then the share of SCST in overseas categories rises much faster than the share of others when the overall participation rate increases. But at the same time, poorer states have greater gap between the demand for labor and the actual supply that NREGA is able to offer. And the share of women in NREGA is higher than the share of women in casual markets. That's because of the additive effect. A lot of women who were not working have now started working. But it's falling as we move from richer states to poorer states. So in poorer states, women are not participating as much. In fact, I think in parts of UP as well as in Bihar, they are even finding it difficult to reach the 33% stipulation, whereas in Kerala it is 93%. Then we also did surveys, apart from the village study that we did, we also did survey with around 1,000 individual farmers. A large group of them, about 600, were either with very marginal land holdings or landless laborers. So we wanted to get their point of view. And then we also interviewed medium and large farmers who were net hirers of labor to get their point of view. So when we talked in the village level on what were the most beneficial aspects that we found of NREGA, this is what came out. So the one thing that figured most prominently in these surveys of 75 villages was that having the opportunity of finding work close to home was the most important, closely followed by creation of useful assets and empowerment of communities in terms of the just the amount of works that they are managing at the panchayat level. And the worst aspects of NREGA were, as Nisha also pointed out, labor becoming lazy. This was a very commonly heard perception. And that, on the other hand, they also felt that the work offered by NREGA was not sufficient, that it should be even more. There were also, interestingly, corruption did not figure as highly as we thought it would. Only in 25% of the cases did people say that that's a big issue. When we talk to the laborers on what are the most attractive aspects of NREGA, availability of work close to home came up again. NREGA offers higher wages than the open market, better facilities, and they also accepted that NREGA work is lighter. And why NREGA is not attractive, they looked at, I'm sure this is a wrong graph.
Yeah, I think the same thing.
Yeah. When we talk to the large farmers, their biggest worry was scarcity of labor that NREGA has created. That they have to pay now higher wages and benefits to the laborers. But they also recognize the creation of useful assets and the improved water security in the villages. So this is a kind of someone can call it arbitrary classification that we made. The first category is what we call misfit. This is a case where the local labor market is already quite vibrant and it offers much better opportunities than NREGA. So NREGA is not actually the right program to implement in such cases. The community response is likely to be lukewarm. But that does not mean that the scale of NREGA implementation is low. And I'll talk about it in more detail later, but I think NREGA, although it's meant to be a demand-driven program, it is actually being run like a supply-pushed program. So the level of NREGA work that is happening in a place is more a function of the capability of the administration to take the push and shove it ahead rather than the demand generated for it. So it has several implications. NREGA is unlikely to excite the local village community, and there will be negligible impact on the already tight labor market because the wages are already high. It might bring new entrants, so like in the case of NREGA, so additive impact is still possible. So without affecting the local labor market, you still get new entrants. But if it is artificially pushed by the administration, then it will lead to poor implementation because obviously, like you see, even in places where Shah and Hindu did work in Punjab, they found that initially everyone wanted a job card and then applied for work, but then nobody turned up. And then they found the administration basically accepting anyone, you know, children under 14, older men who were not, visibly not ready to work, as well as migrant laborers from Bihar who were doing the NREGA work. And it would obviously distort the work ethic among laborers because then they are basically saying, look, come and just sign and take your money. Type 2 is insignificant, and I think this is the case in many of the tribal areas, as well as in areas like Bihar, where the total size of NREGA work offered is a very small proportion of the total labor market. So there is a demand for more forceful implementation, but because of limited capacities of the administration, that is not happening. Third is potentially significant. I think this is true for South Gujarat as well as Mandla in MP, where we did studies, where there is huge gap between the existing labor market wage rates, which are like 40 or 50 rupees, and what NREGA is offering. So potentially NREGA can have a very significant impact. But again, due to administrative bottlenecks or various other reasons, in some cases it is also corruption, NREGA implementation is very poor, and therefore the impact is only a potential, and it leads to disappointment and disillusionment among the laborers. In South Gujarat, we found that initially the laborers were very excited about NREGA. They also did work in the first year, but then they realized that there were huge delays in payment of wages. So they just gave up on it and then went back to their 40 rupees a day cash in the evening kind of work. And in the areas where the impact is significant, this is where the non-wage benefits of NREGA will also attract entire village, not just the laborers. And this has happened mostly where, in Kerala, for example, where a dynamic panchayat leader decided to use NREGA to get some political mileage. There is both pluses and minuses for the large landowners. Pluses in the sense, if the assets created are useful, then they also stand to benefit from it. But of course, the labor market gets tighter, their cost of cultivation goes up. In some places, we even found, like in Anand, what was happening was that, or at least that is what the laborers reported, that the large landowners, the Patels, in collusion with the panchayat, made sure that there was no NREGA work implemented during the peak agriculture season. So NREGA work was only implemented when there was a relative lax in the agriculture. And at the peak time, there was no effect on the labor market.
Thank you. Thanks, sir.